morning and welcome back.
Good morning.
So glad that you're here. If you were here last week, it seemed like it. We're glad you're back today. To everyone who may be watching at home, we wish that you were with us, but we certainly completely understand every individual's decisions that they need to make for their own circumstance. So we ask that God would be with all of us, whether we're in this building or not, that we would all be gathered together for his worship. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you and we praise you for this day. May we receive this day like the psalmist did, that this is the day that you have made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us rejoice because we come before you a sinful people, but through the blood of Christ. So we confess, Lord, our sins to you, but we rejoice in our salvation. And Lord, this day may be a day of rest and ease and comfort and enjoyment for some, and then let us rejoice and be glad in that. This day may also be a day that has some challenges and difficulties and anxieties for some. Let us rejoice that we do not have to deal with those alone. You, our good shepherd, are with us, leading us. Be with us this morning. In Jesus' name.
Comes from the book of Psalm, chapter 103, verses 1 through 5 and 20 to 22. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Bless the Lord, O you angels, you mighty ones who do his word, obeying the voice of his word. Bless the Lord and his hosts, his ministers who do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works, in all the places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Thank you.
golfer.
I did everything I had. Oh, goodness. For the children, and I said last week, I'd love to ask you to come down. I can't, but this is specifically for the children. We've been talking earlier on this year, and then before we stopped meeting, and now that we're meeting again, talking about prayer and different things about prayer, a lot of important things about prayer. And I wanted to tell you this morning that God gives us great help in praying. It's one of the uses of the Bible. That we can open the Bible in almost every place and pray what the Bible says. We can just pray the words of the Bible, and then we can also just apply those to maybe a situation. And I'm going to just pick one little section, a very familiar section from Scripture, and talk about that this morning. And that's the 23rd Psalm, which many of you may know. Maybe you've memorized that. And it starts off, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters." You've heard this probably before. Well, I just want to talk about that first verse. The Lord is my shepherd. That means that Jesus himself is walking in front of me, protecting me, providing for me, taking care of me, making sure I go in the right places. And so when I feel afraid or I feel confused and I don't know what to do next, and we think about things, right? We try to figure things out. We use information. But then we can go right to that verse and pray, "God, you said that Jesus is my shepherd. You said Jesus would lead me. Jesus, please lead me now. Please show me where to go. Please take care of me. You've promised you would." Now, I am going to, my part is, when I pray that, my part is, I'm going to be the sheep, right? I'm going to follow where he says to go and do what he says to do. If not, that prayer doesn't work quite so well. But if we do, God will do all the things that he's promised to do for us. Let's pray about that. Heavenly Father, we thank you as always for children that come here, families that come here, that they may be more like you, that they may teach your children to be more like you. And Lord, help us to remember all the time. When times are good and when times are hard, when times are happy, when times are sad, we should always pray. And that we're not just saying words out into empty space, we're speaking into the ears of our shepherd. So help us to be peaceful, knowing that Jesus will lead us. And you use people to help us see that. You use church to help us see that. And you use the Bible. And you use prayer to help us remember that. In Jesus' name, amen. And all is on that day. I start so you can go back to your seat. You're already there. Yeah. So as we just talk to our children and pray with our children now, let us all pray together. And part of that prayer is going to be for our children. And as we pray that, I would ask that each of you look around right now. I hope you know the names. If you don't know the names of these children, at least get an image of them in your mind. And as we're praying, pray for these children. When I pray for the church, pray for our church, and pray for churches in our community. Let's pray. Gracious God, in the midst of this very interesting time, the times in which we live, the times in which you have us living, Lord, we're thankful for our children. Those of us who are older are thankful for our adult children. And we're thankful for our teenage children. We're thankful for our youngest children. Lord, as a church family, we are thankful for the children who are the children of this family. May we all see the children who are part of Three Stones Church as part of our own family. Lord, I just ask that you would continue to lead them in the way that they would go, that you would use their parents first, and Sunday school teachers and others in the church to help point them to you, that they would continue to go the way of the Good Shepherd. So Lord, bless our children. work through the difficulties of and the challenges of coming back together and reaching out to those who are at home, and knowing that some are very ill. Lord, we just ask that you would bless us. Bless us with a connection. Bless us in each other and through each other as we reach out to one another. Lord, bless our community through us. As you promised to Abraham that you would bless him in order that he would be a blessing, Lord, we ask that you bless us not just for our own good, but that we would be a blessing. That many would come. That you would save many. Lord, not just for us. We pray this for the other churches in our community. That the gospel would be preached. That your word would be preached as it is written. Preached faithfully, heard faithfully, and obeyed faithfully. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. These are indeed interesting times, and they continue to be interesting things. Continue to happen. We continue to see interesting things. I was out at about 5:30 the other morning and saw a group of people gathered in the driveway at Troop 3, the State Troopers Barracks. For one, it surprised me to see a bunch of other people up that early in the morning. But the other, just things have come close to us, and we need to consider these things. And to help us with that, we're going to return to the Psalms where we were last week. We're going to go to Psalm 4, the fourth Psalm, this week. In 1555, Dr. Nicholas Ridley was sentenced to be burned at the stake in England for his witness for Christ. On the night before Ridley's execution, his brother came to visit him in prison and offered to stay with him in his cell that night to assist and comfort him. Dr. Ridley declined his brother's offer, saying, "I intend, God willing, go to bed and sleep as quietly tonight as I ever did." He said this because he knew the peace of God. He could rest in the strength of the everlasting arms of God himself to meet his needs. We're not facing being burned at the stake. At least, I don't think any of us are, but we live in these times which are fraught with anxiety. Just 3 short months ago, right? There were mortgages, car payments, and kids hearing about being accepted to college, and other kids getting ready to graduate from college and look for a job. Our own employment had its own worries. There were bills, trying to keep our cars running, the state of our country, on and on. There were plenty of things to be anxious about. And then, COVID-19. And then the George Floyd tragedy, and then the peaceful protests, and the violent protests, and the looting, and parts of cities being occupied. And some of that has come close to home. I mean, they're protesting in Camden, Delaware. I think they've gotten just about everywhere. These are the days in which we live. And I know there's much anxiety. I hear about it from many on a daily basis. So what are we to do? Well, I sought the help of Psychology Today. They offer these things. And believe me, I'm in no way minimizing or trivializing mental health issues or mental health. There is a need for that and a use for that. But this little article, these little bullet points, I found interesting. Lifestyle changes can help people who experience feelings of anxiety but who don't meet the clinical threshold for a diagnosis. Habits such as exercise, sleeping well, and limiting the amount of alcohol and caffeine that are consumed are all helpful. Okay, that sounds good. identifying circumstances that trigger one's anxiety, and then pushing back against anxious or irrational thoughts can help to feel better prepared for the future. Okay? I'm with them, but then they lost me. Increasingly, researchers argue that mindfulness meditation is a successful technique as well. I didn't know what mindfulness meditation was. At first I thought they said mindless meditation. Then I went back and says they say this. Mindfulness meditation, one turns their attention to a single point of reference, such as one's breath or bodily sensations or a word or a phrase or a mantra. The practice has been shown to decrease distraction and rumination, make negative automatic thoughts seem easier to let go of, and promote greater enjoyment for the present moment. As he sat in his cell preparing to be burned alive, I wonder if mindless meditation would have helped Dr. Nicholas Ridley. Well, friends, the Bible offers a real solution, a better solution, and an eternal solution. So if you have your Bibles, and I hope you do, turn to the fourth chapter of the Psalms. Father God, as we open your word, let us remember, help us to remember that this is indeed your word. Engrave its truth in our mind and upon our hearts and in our memory. May your Holy Spirit teach us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Before I read this, I want to mention a word. You've probably come across this if you read the Psalms, and 71 times in the Psalms, and one time, the only other time in the Bible, in Habakkuk, and it's the word Selah, S-E-L-A-H, usually in italics, often at the end of a phrase. There is a certain amount of, not really debate, but a number of meanings that have been ascribed to Selah. They don't have the exact meaning anywhere. One possibility is the Hebrew word kalah, which means to measure or weigh, like the value of something. Another possibility comes from two different words, salah, and I'm probably butchering these pronunciations, which means to praise, and salal, which means to lift up. There's another commentator who believes it comes from a longer, differently spelled word, salah, which means to pause. And this might be even a musical notation, a musical rest for singers to take a breath, or to sing a cappella, or to let the instruments play, or to pause and offer up praise other than those words. I think it's probably all of those. I think it's probably that we're pausing to consider the weight and value of what we're hearing, that we're lifting up praise, and then maybe that physical thing where we actually stop there and consider those other things. Okay, on to Psalm 4. In this psalm, King David expresses complete and utter trust in God in the middle of a very difficult time. I think it's helpful for us to hear his personal lamenting, but right alongside that is his absolute unwavering confidence in the Lord. And as we read this, I want you to listen for this pattern that begins with a prayer. It moves on to David speaking to ungodly people. Then it moves on to David to speaking to godly people. Then it comes back to prayer. So Psalm 4, with the notation, and this is in Scripture, to the choir master with stringed instruments, a psalm of David. Answer me when I call, O God of my righteousness. You have given me relief when I was in distress. Be gracious to me and hear my prayer. O men, how long shall my honor be turned into shame? How long will you love vain words and seek after lies? But know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. Be angry and do not sin. Ponder in your own hearts on your beds and be silent. Offer right sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. There are many who say, who will show us some good? Lift up the light of your face upon us, O Lord. You have put more joy in my heart than they have when their grain and wine abound. In peace, I will both lie down and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. Well, let's take a look at these verses and then come around to some ways I think we can use these verses. Verse 1, we hear a confident prayer. David pleading for God to listen to him and remembering what it is that God has done for him in the past and asking God to graciously do it again. And then, as I said earlier, David moves his speech now from prayer to talking to ungodly people, to the faithless who are around him. And indeed, I think we need to consider these words to those who don't know Christ. He says, O men, how long shall my honor be turned into shame? Meaning David specifically as a king and has been looked down upon, has been chased from his throne. If this runs chronologically after Psalm 3, which we're not really sure if it does, but if it does, this will be a time when he's fleeing from his own son who's seeking to kill him, Absalom. And he says to those, know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. So those of you who would be after me, understand this. God has set me apart. And what great news that is, that God has set his people apart for blessing. For eternity, he set those apart to save. And he lets them know that the Lord hears when he prays. So he prays and then he talks to the ungodly and says, know this. Basically, whatever you do here, God has saved me. He hears me when I pray. Well, then David moves on to speak to the godly, where they're encouraged and they're warned not to give in to anger. In your anger, do not sin, he says. This is not a command to be angry and then not sin. This is saying when you're angry, because I think David understood, as God does, as we all know, that there are times when we are angry, but he says, be angry, but do not sin. Paul repeats this in the letter to Ephesians. Instead, he says, be quiet. Ponder in your own hearts, on your beds, and be silent. This does not mean that we can't tell people when we're angry that we're angry with them. This does not mean we can't even pursue legal recourse if that's necessary when something happens to us. What it means is we don't seek personal revenge. We don't take from God that which is God's. Then in the last three verses, he returns to prayer. There are many who say, who will show us some good? Lift up the light of your face upon us, O Lord. You have put more joy in my heart than they have when their grain and wine abound. In peace, I will both lie down and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety. David began with prayer, spoke to the ungodly, spoke to the godly, then he returns to prayer. And each of us should hear our own crying out. Who will show us some good? Isn't that what we're hearing? Not those words, but isn't that what we're hearing when we turn on the TV now? When we watch the news, we watch what's going on around our country? Aren't people crying out for some good? So how does David respond to that? David was a warrior. David was a tough guy. He fought battles. Remember when he first came as a little boy and he comes into to Saul's presence and he says, I killed the lion and the bear. Bear hands. And then he takes on Goliath. Later, he will fight battles against his own pride and his own sin, and he will fight actual battles, actual wars, and defeat many enemies. He'll fight the unrighteous Saul. He'll fight nation upon nation and army upon army. Well, what does he do when he's oppressed? This mighty man of God goes running and leaping into the arms of his Father, seeking help, seeking peace. He's seeking here sleep and rest, even though he walks through the valley of the shadow of death. Right? Even though that's where he's walking. When his shepherd leads him to green pastures, he's going to lay down and rest. Brothers and sisters, these are the days in which we live, and these are the days in which we are meant to live. I can't help but think of the uncle's words to the niece. We're born for a time such as this. I think the church was born for a time such as this. Can we as individual Christians, can we as a church learn from David here? I think we can. If we go to the New Testament, I hear Paul writing to the Philippians and encouraging them. The Lord is at hand, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And I know that Paul read what David had written. So as we seek not to be anxious about anything, let's hear how David accomplished this peace. I want to consider just for a moment before I jump into some points. I want to consider David speaking to the ungodly here. David speaking to the unsaved. How long will you love vain words and seek after lies, but know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself? I don't want to put words into David's mouth here, but friends, when we are speaking to the ungodly, the unsaved, we don't think of ungodly necessarily as being people who we would call bad people. Though none are good, but Christ alone. But they are people who are unsaved. That's who he's referring to here. And we should always be prepared to tell them that the Lord has set apart some for himself, and he will save them. We should be ready with the gospel to speak to those. But specifically, I want to talk about these points that I think we can learn from Psalm 4. There are six things, and they're brief, each one of them. First one is to pray. The second one is to be angry correctly. Third is reflect. The fourth is to worship correctly. The fifth, enjoy God. And the sixth brings us back to pray, but it's pray and rest. David opens this asking God to hear his prayer. Be gracious to me and hear his prayer. Why would he be asking for God to hear his prayer? Isn't that God's job? No. God is under no obligation to hear us when we pray. We are enemies to God. We come to him as sinful people. But the grace of God, the mercy of God, through the blood of Christ, allows us to pray, and he indeed desires for us to pray. And pray for his grace. And pray for his mercy. So we pray. To find peace, to find freedom from anxiety, regardless of what's going on around us, we must pray. Second one is this, be angry correctly. Again, verse 4 where it says, be angry and do not sin, is not a mandate to be angry. It's an understanding that when we are angry, we are not to sin. Again, you can express yourself. You can tell the person you're angry with them. but do not sin. Do not take from God what is rightly God's, and that is revenge, that is vengeance. The third thing, which is tied directly to that, is reflection. David says, ponder in your own hearts, on your beds, and be silent. That's very practical. There's nothing to be read into that. That's exactly what it means. When you go to bed at night, lay down and think about yourself. Reflect about yourself. A good exercise is, what did I do at 10 o'clock this morning? What did I do at noon? What did I do after lunch? And this isn't a list of our activities. This is, how was I loving to those around me? How did I show Christ to those around me? Was I in worship during those hours of the day? Were the things that I was taking part in, would they honor and glorify God? This type of reflection is invaluable, but it's, I think, underused because it's underrated. In this day, we're often expected, I think, to point to other people for the problems in our lives. And David says, ponder on your own, in your own hearts, and on your beds, and be silent. Be silent. I find those words personally very convicting. There are times to be silent. This is the guy, right, who God said to him, be still and know that I am God. If that was a math equation where A equals B, and then you put not A, what'd you have to put on the other side? Not B. Right? So not being still would equal not knowing God truly. So David heard God say, be still. David took it to heart, and then at some point he wrote down, be silent. For our benefit. Sometimes we need to be silent in a conversation. Sometimes when we go back one step there to being angry and not sinning, sometimes being silent when you're angry is a great help. Rather than just lashing back out, sometimes being silent changes what you will say next. There are times to be alone, reflecting, silently reflecting. Silence is necessary to reflecting, and self-reflection is vital to self-control. And self-control is vital to being angry without sinning. The fourth thing, offer right sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. The fourth thing for us is to worship correctly. Well, what's that mean? Well, we don't know exactly what David meant here, but there are a number of things that we know that people who supposedly followed God did wrongly in the Old Testament and even carried into the New. Sacrifices that were offered to false gods. Sacrifices offered in the wrong way to our God. And sacrifices which were offered correctly according to ritual, but that were divorced from a heart that was worshiping God. So no Old Testament sacrifice of rams or bulls, or no Sunday morning offerings, no activity in church, nothing can overcome a heart that isn't worshiping God. You know, it's like giving. What we told God loves is a cheerful giver. It's the heart behind what we do. Doing the things are wildly important, but it's the heart behind what we do. And no check written for any purpose in the church can ever overcome disobedience to God's will. And if we are not worshiping well, if we're not actually accomplishing worship with what we're doing, that will always cause an inner anxiety that we may or may not identify. But it will be there. Number five, too, enjoy God. This great quote from Charles Spurgeon, who said this, reflecting on Psalm 4. There were many, even among David's own followers, who wanted to see rather than believe. Alas, this is a tendency of us all. Even the regenerate sometimes groan after the sense and sight of prosperity and are sad when darkness covers all good from view. As for the worldling, I don't use that much anymore, as for the people of this world, not of Christ. As for the worldlings, this is their unceasing cry. Who will show us any good? Never satisfied, their gaping mouths are turned in every direction. The empty hearts are ready to drink any fine and good delusion which impostors may invent. And when these fail, they soon yield to despair and declare that there is no good either in heaven or earth. But the true believer is from a very different mold. His face is not downward like the beast, but upward like the angels. He drinks not from the muddy pools of mammon, but from the fountain of life above. The light of God's countenance is enough for him. This, the light of God's countenance, this is his riches. This is his honor. This is his health. This is his ambition. This is his ease. Give him this, and he will ask for no more. This is joy, unspeakable and full of glory. And I'm just going to leave that with Spurgeon. So the sixth is to pray and to rest. And you may note that in this final prayer, this last couple of verses, that David prayed a little differently. In verse 1, he prayed, "Answer me when I call, me and I." In verse 6, he prays, "Lift up the light of your face upon us." So David entered this praying to God, and that allowed him to speak to the ungodly. It allowed him to instruct the godly. And now he's praying for us all. In the midst of battle, in the midst of being threatened, his life genuinely threatened. Not just generally threatened, not just that there's some bad guys in the world and one of them may find you. No, people are after David to kill him. And very much like the man in jail getting ready to be burned at the stake, the next day, David does what? In peace, I will go down and sleep. Isn't that what we need, friends? In peace, to lie down and sleep. To have peace in these times we live. Don't we need the peace of God? We can't get enough stuff. Like if we go back to the store tomorrow morning and they completely restock their shelves, that will not bring us peace. It may bring us temporary ease, but it won't bring us peace. If the rioting stops, that will not bring us peace. It will make us feel better about that thing, but it will not bring us peace. The only thing that brings a lasting, eternal peace is the peace of God himself. So I heard Mark Dever ask his congregation some questions, and I asked myself these questions daily this week, and I'm going to continue to do that. I'd like to ask you these questions, and just for your own reflection, going back to that reflection thing we were talking about, and maybe you might want to write these down and use these. I'm not looking for anyone to raise a hand and answer here. Question number one, do you depend on God? You don't know the right church answer, but in an honest, by yourself, reflecting on your bed at night in the dark alone, can you say you depend on God? Number two, do you pray? Do you turn to him in times of trouble? Is that a first recourse when things are difficult? Do you ask for his mercy through the cross of Christ? Regularly asking for his mercy through the cross of Christ. Do you believe the truth that the Bible teaches about God? Do you give time to read, to study, to reflect upon the Scriptures, and to reflect upon your own life? I hope so. I pray so. And I pray those things for myself. The sermon is very much looking in the mirror. And I'm going to follow up with an uncomfortable question the same way he did when he asked those questions. So he asked, do you give time to read, to study, reflect upon the Scriptures, and reflect upon your life? Then he said, okay, when? Yesterday? When yesterday did you pray? When yesterday did you spend time reflecting upon Scripture? When yesterday did you spend time studying and reflecting upon your own life? Okay, it was Saturday. Saturdays are different and busier. What about Friday or Thursday? None of this is to make us feel guilty about not being able to honestly, with integrity, saying yes to all those questions. What this is encouragement, I hope, to find the places where we can't say yes and to begin to say yes to those things. If we can begin to say yes to those things, then we will receive that peace that passes understanding. If we will do these things, we will be able to rest and to sleep in peace. If we pray, if we control our anger, if we reflect on our own lives, if we worship with a clear and clean heart, if we enjoy God. I think this is summed up well in the first question of the Westminster Shorter Catechism, which asks this, and when it says the word end, it means goal or purpose. What is the chief end of man? What is man's main purpose? What is man's main reason for existence? And the answer is this. The chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. And these are difficult times in which we live, but these are the times in which we're supposed to live. You were born for this. You were born for a time such as this. We can change the world for the glory of God if we will seek His peace and pursue it, and then walk into the world carrying that peace. Heavenly Father, help us. Help us, we pray. Help us to seek You. To be sinless in anger. To reflect upon our lives, even an hour at a time, even a day at a time. Help us to turn to You, God. Give us joy that we might enjoy You forever. Amen.
Please stand with me, church, as we sing our closing song.
Thank you.
we take just a moment, could you close your eyes just for a moment? And I want you to think about this, like, you know, before you leave, get all your stuff together, get your Bible and your purse and your jacket and your kids up and get it all together. But just for a moment, gather together what we have heard this morning, what we've been singing this morning, the living hope of Christ, the promise of peace, and the way to establish it in our own lives. Gather that up. Don't leave it behind. Don't leave it on your chair. Gather it up. Friends, it is not surprising to come across things throughout the Bible, like to hear Paul talking about being peaceful and hearing it from David, because the same truths are true throughout Scripture. So, do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint. To him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary. Young men shall fall and be exhausted. Are you tired? Are you exhausted? Are you anxious? Are you worn out? Is this just too much? Well, those who wait on the Lord will renew their strength. They will mount up with wings as eagles. They will run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you all the health, happiness, wholeness, all that is peace with God. May he give you shalom. Amen.